It's good to be in the house of the Lord. I came to worship. Did you come to worship Him? Let's lift Him up this morning.
I raise a hallelujah.
Louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar up from the
that hallelujah. I'm going to sing no matter what the circumstances are, no matter what I'm faced with in my life. I'm going to sing in that middle of the storm. You know, not long ago, I was talking to someone. They said, you know, I've been really happy, and it's been really easy to praise the Lord. But I had something happen. And maybe they had just testified about how they were on that mountain, and it was really easy. But she looked at me, and she said, but, you know, maybe that's why I'm walking through what I'm walking through right now. It's because I need to learn to worship Him, even sometimes when it's not very happy in my life. Sometimes it's not easy, but He's still worthy. Hallelujah. I have felt His presence in this place from the moment I walked into prayer time. And if you're not in prayer time, if you can make it, come make it. Because it makes all the difference. It makes all the difference. I have walked in. I have three kids. And I try to get them here with me. And it's not easy sometimes. Sometimes I'm dragging Jackson Chester, yelling at him from upstairs, get down here, let's go. But I never regret it. Even if I come in just a few minutes late, I have never regretted it. God is so good. You can be seated just for a moment. Today is a special day. And today is Grandparents' Day. If you're a grandparent, just wave at me. Oh my, look at all these grandparents. We have so many grandparents here. Well, it is so good to have everyone with us. But today we want to honor you. You know, my dad, he tells a little joke and he says, you know, if I knew grandchildren were going to be so grand, I would have had them first. He always says that, and I think, well, you know. But at this time, we have a short video.
If you hold tickets, I love her so much.
I love Mom, and her's my favorite one forever. And I love her.
Grandma makes me happy. Whenever we have a sleepover there, whenever we wake up, we eat breakfast, is because me and my brother wake up really early. We see their cat crawling around, and he really doesn't like us. And then my brother always tries to chase him, and we hiss him, and their cat hisses at him.
Hey, Grandma, I just wanted to say that I'm thankful for all the time you came outside and played basketball, baseball, football, everything with me, because I didn't have no one to play with, and you came and played with me. So I thank you for that. And Papa, I remember you too from stealing all my candy and stuff whenever Grandma would buy it for me. I love y'all.
I just wanted to thank my Grandma and Papa. Like, Grandma, you always like say bingo and how we go back and forth with that joke. And then, Papa, whenever you play checkers with me, and then like we try to play chess, and just like helping me out with my homework and everything. Love you guys.
Some of my favorite, or one of my favorite memories of my grandparents is me and a lot of my cousins would go and spend the night, and we would have pallets on the living room floor, and we would just stay up all night laughing. Playing, and then we'd get up the next morning and they would cook us breakfast. So yeah, I think that's one of my favorite memories of my grandparents when I was young. But I loved all my grandparents, and they've all had a very important part of my life, of who I am today.
I want to tell you what I love about my grandparents. They've all passed on and gone to be with Jesus, but I remember when I was little, it was always special to go spend the night at their house. I remember going fishing with both of my grandfathers, caught my first fish with one of my grandfathers, and my Nana, especially, I remember making breakfast in the morning or lunch, and she would always cut the toast or the sandwiches in triangles and make sure the butter was already spread all the way out to the edge. And, you know, I just remember being very loved and feeling very special in their house, and that's what I loved about my grandparents.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay. Hi, my name is Shelby, for everyone who doesn't know me. Today I'm going to read a poem about grandparents, a very nice poem that I think wraps up exactly how we feel and how special they are to us. It says, "Few can bring the warmth we can find in their embrace, and little more is needed to bring love than the smile on their face. They have a supply of sweet stories that they have time to wipe a tear, or give us reasons to make us laugh, they grow most precious through the years. I believe that God sent us grandparents as our legacy from above to share the moments of our life as extra measures of his love."
Today I wrote a little something about my grandparents, and hopefully I don't cry the entire time I say it, because I did cry while writing it. But my grandparents. I'm so thankful that God gave us grandparents. My grandparents are very special to me. They have always been there for me. From the day I was born to every sport and school event that I have, they always support me. They always let us spend the night at their house and feed us the best food. And my pa tells me that when I go to his house, I don't even have to ask. He says, just go get it. He tells me not to ask. He says I'm not allowed to ask to go get food. But my Jan, she always keeps me looking nice. Every time she sees me, she tries to buy me a new outfit. My pa always tells me that if there ever is a time that I don't feel loved, to remember that he loves me and God loves me. My pa always calls me to make sure I'm doing okay. My nanny always makes sure we have the prettiest package every holiday. Even though she lives in Kentucky, she always sends the prettiest package with the best gifts for us. And I remember the sweetest laugh and smile my papa had every time we would drive from Alabama to Kentucky. He would be so happy to see us. Most importantly, all of my grandparents pray for me. And they don't care if I graduate high school with the highest GPA, or if I have the best job or the best house. All they want is to see me and my family saved. I thank my grandparents today for how they've raised my parents and how they've taught my parents how to raise us. I thank my papa for teaching my dad how to be a good godly man and a good godly father. And I thank my Jan for teaching my mother how to be a good godly woman and how to be a good godly mother. I wouldn't be the person I am today without their influence on me and my parents' lives. So to my grandparents today, thank you. Thank you for your love to me and all of our family. We love and appreciate you today.
Hello, and today I will be saying a poem for Grandparents Day. Grandmas and grandpas brighten our days, even if they are far, far away. When they're not here, their smiles we miss, but since you are here, I will blow you a kiss.
Special. Happy Grandparents Day to you. I'm so proud of Mariah. Thank you for doing that. And Miss Shelby and Lauren, I have tears now. But I just have to say, growing up, I never lived near grandparents. And the ministry, we moved here and there. But if you're here today, you don't have biological grandparents, I'm going to tell you what made the biggest difference in my life was every church that my father ever pastored, God always sent me a grandparent. They may not have lived near my grandparents may not have lived near me, but God always sent me someone who would help fill that void. And some of you have done that even for my children here today. But I will never forget, there was a little lady at Piedmont Church here in South Carolina. And she came, and she did not have grandchildren. And she said, "Pastor Puckett, I would like to pick up Courtney and I want to teach her how to make Rice Krispie treats. And it is a memory that I will have and carry with me forever, that this little lady, at the time I didn't realize she just wanted to spend time with me because she cared about me. I just thought she wanted to have fun by cooking. But as I've gotten older, I realized she just wanted to spend time with me. And it made all the difference in the world. Brother Sam Burney and Miss Cherie, when we moved here, when we were in transition, they took us into our home and they became grandparents to my children. And Brother Sam would get out there and play basketball with them, wouldn't he, Jackson? And he probably beat Jackson too. But happy Grandparents Day to you. Some of us have grandparents that have already gone, but we carry on their legacy. We can carry on their legacy and the memories of who they are. So everyone stand with us if you don't mind. I'm going to pray a special prayer over our grandparents as our pastor comes. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for all that you have done for us. Lord, I thank you for the gift of family. Lord, we are so blessed to have the gift of family. Lord, whether it be by blood or whether it just be a good friend that's become family, Lord, I just thank you for that, Lord. It's such a gift. It's such a blessing. And God, I thank you for grandparents, Lord, every grandparent that's in this room. Lord, I thank you for the legacy that my grandparents have given me, Lord, the legacy of living for the Lord and spreading the gospel for the Lord. And I just thank you for that, Father. And God, today, as each grandparent is here, Lord, help them to feel loved and to know, God, that they are special to you and they're special to their families. We love you and we praise you for all that you've done today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You can be seated just for a moment again. I'm going to ask our ushers to come this morning, and it is a wonderful day as we celebrate our grandparents. We love each and every one of you. I do want to encourage our grandparents. I know some of you bring your grandchildren to church. I want to tell you, the Lord knows and will bless every effort you make to have your family in the house of God. And we want to minister to your grandchildren, all of our children and our families, and we want to thank you for your efforts and everything you do in trying to instill the Word of God and the preaching and the teaching and all the things that are done around here. We want to thank you for trying to raise up your families in the Lord and your efforts. I believe God is richly blessing those. Amen. We've got some wonderful children around here, and we thank you for being wonderful grandparents and parents in this house. Lord, we just thank you today. Lord, today, God, for the family of God. Lord, thank you for men and women, God, I pray, who have, Lord, decided that, Lord, in everything they do, they are going to follow you, God. They're going to raise their families, God. They're going to, Lord, raise their grandchildren, God, I pray, and teach them about you. Thank you for the wonderful examples that I've had in my life, God. And today, Lord, as we give, God, we're giving, Lord God, Lord, to the mission field, Lord God, as we give to our United Missions Fund, God. And, Lord, these funds, Lord, go out, Lord God, onto that field, Lord, where, Lord, people are being ministered to. The gospel is going forth. Lord, pastors are being trained. Churches are being planted, God. I'm asking you, Lord, that this family of God, Lord, as we invest, Lord God, Lord, in the people of God and the things of God around this world and the Word of God going forth, that, Lord, it wouldn't return in vain, but, God, you would bless and multiply, Lord God, our efforts, some 30, some 60, some 100-fold, Lord God. I pray that you would bless Brother Chalk on the mission field, Brother Brandon, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, Lord, that you would just bless and move in his family, Lord, in a mighty way. Lord, you are a great and mighty God, and we just believe that your word, Lord God, can transform a life today. And as we give, God, I pray, Lord, just use it for your glory. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
let's continue to worship the Lord this morning.
Turn to you.
everybody's welcome. And just that one statement, do you realize how the weight of it and how important it is? Oh, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Oh, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Because you're worthy of all of our praises. We pray that you'll come have your way. Come and have your way. You know, I want to build my life upon his way. I want to build my life upon him and who he is. My life is nothing if I don't build it on the firm foundation of Jesus Christ. You know, I learned that as a child. The wise man, he builds his house upon the rock. But the foolish man builds his house upon the... You know what? When we moved here, Pastor and I, we went out and we walked outside around our house. And he said, look at all this sand. Look at all this sand. Do we build our house upon the sand? You know, the Bible tells us. He was teasing. But really, we should build our house upon the rock. It's the only thing that builds my life is Jesus Christ. The only one that matters in my life is Jesus Christ. And the fact that my daughter can stand up here and say, my parents don't really care what GPA I have as long as I love the Lord. Listen, if she'll carry that forever, I will feel like I have conquered the world. There's nothing more important than building our life upon the Lord.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing.
To him and holy.
doing a work in this place. I can see it, and I can sense it, and I can feel it in His presence. He's doing a work individually in people's hearts and lives right this very moment. And I want to be sensitive to that. 'Cause holy, there is no one like You. There is none beside.
My devotional time this morning, I was reminded in the book of 2 Timothy by a pastor friend of mine that the Lord is faithful even when we're not. And the Bible tells us He's faithful because that is who He is. That's His character. And this morning, hallelujah, what a wonderful presence of the Lord here today. And I don't know what happened this week in your life. I don't know what's going on. But He is faithful. And because He is faithful, I believe we can become more faithful. Amen? Amen. If you got your Bibles, I want to go to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. I rarely just put two messages together, but I did this week. And I felt like I kept pulling back towards this text, and I just believe this is for somebody today. But the Hebrew writer said in verse 35, "Cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul." Lord, we come to You today, God. Again, Your presence is here, Lord. And I thank You that, Lord, it just seems like every time we walk in this building, Your presence, Lord, it is strong in this place. Lord, there's a work that needs to be done, God, in our hearts and in our lives, including this pastor today. And let us be yielded to You in such a way, God, that the Holy Ghost can work through this word today. Lord, bless our people. Strengthen us in this place, God. And Lord, help us, God, to put our confidence, our trust, our faith completely in who You are. In Jesus' name, all of God's people said, amen. Just look at somebody on the way down and say, "Boy, you look pretty today." I think some of you fellas got tongue-tied on that one, didn't you? Oh, amen. Boy, it's good to see people in the house of God worshiping God this morning. There's a passage of Scripture in John chapter 6. Jesus said, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give in my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us flesh to eat? Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, my blood is drink indeed. And he that eat my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. He said, I am bread that came down from heaven. If you eat this bread, you will never be hungry again. Now, to read that passage, that sounds like some very strange words this morning. But Jesus said those words because he was teaching people, I'm not just to be followed just because I can do good things for you. I'm to be followed and to be received and to be believed because I've come to be your very life. He said earlier in this chapter, in verse 26, ye seek me not because ye saw miracles, but because ye did eat the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him hath God the Father sealed. Then said they unto him, what shall we do, that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered unto them, this is the work of God, that ye believe on him who he hath sent. Later on in this chapter, it says, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. And I want to say today, we are living in a world that is passing away. The wrath of God, the judgment of God, it hangs over this world. It's hanging over this nation. This world is under a curse of sin. And I believe all that we've seen in the last several years, we're facing an upheaval in our lives and our way of life like we've never seen before. To the place as believers in Jesus Christ, you know what's happening? I see people growing tired and weary of all that is taking place in this world. Man, I remember there was a day, man, it's different than today. There was a day when I would get on a bike and ride through the neighborhood and my mom and dad wouldn't see me till that evening when mama called for supper. We're not living in that day. We're seeing things around us where we're preparing and in fear sometimes of even going out, and we're seeing all kinds of crazy things happening. But I believe we are in a choose you this day moment. God is taking the middle ground away, and as depression and oppression from the enemy intensifies, we've seen in recent years with all of this pandemic and everything that has happened through all of that, something has entered our world that has changed everything. I believe it's changed our life as believers. I believe it's going to change our life as a believer from now until Jesus comes. We're seeing more sickness now than I've ever seen in my life. There are more family issues and problems than I have ever dealt with in the ministry. There's more anxiety in the lives of people than I have ever seen before. And people are finding themselves looking for answers. And it's become a time where I believe people, even God's people, are coming to a realization one day I'm going to pass on into eternity. There's more. There's got to be more than what we're experiencing in this life. And as we are facing eternity this morning, I see people who have placed their confidence in things and in governments and in finances and in men and in organizations. You know, we've made our entertainment and our pleasure in this country has really become a god to us in many ways. I was sitting in my living room last night and I watched. I thought, man, I'm going to turn on the Alabama Crimson Tide. You know, as a Kentucky football fan, you have to live vicariously through somebody else. And I spent 10 years in Alabama, and I decided, hey, when I went there, they said, you got to pick a side. I said, well, we didn't even like Auburn in Kentucky, so I'm going to roll with the Tide. I turned it on last night. I saw people everywhere packed in. I'm talking about as tight as they can be. If they come in a church house, they wouldn't sit that close to anybody. But they were packed in. They had their streamers and their banners going, didn't they, Brother Ray? I know you watched it. Man, they had the house rocking. The announcer said, we can barely hear. We can barely hear to talk to each other. It was so loud. Tennessee or Texas came out, and that whole place had their horns down. Boo! Man, they were all in unison. They were all excited. They were all pumped up. They had placed their confidence in Nick Saban. I'm telling you, if Nick Saban ran for governor of Alabama, he could get elected tomorrow. And I sat there and thought, Nick's got another one in the bag tonight. You know, this morning there's some very upset people. There's some very disappointed people. I'm going to tell you, because I pastored in Alabama for 10 years, there's some people that didn't go to church this morning because they were so upset. That's the truth. And if they were in church, they had a face that was so sour they couldn't even lift up the name of Jesus. You know why? Because we put confidence in things that are temporary, things that fail, things that disappoint. I'm telling you, even today as your pastor, I love you today. I mean, the Lord just put a love in our heart for you when I step foot on this stage. I hope you love me. I'll even accept like. But I want there to be a certain level of confidence in the leadership of this church. But you know, at some point, I may disappoint you. At some point, I may do something that you misunderstood or you may not like. At some point, I may do something that I hope I don't, but I may get on the bad side of Sister Patty, and I know that's not a place I want to be. I tell you what, this dear sister comes and hugs my neck after every service. It don't matter if I laid an egg. She said, that's good, preacher. That's good preaching, preacher. That's why I look this way all the time. I'm telling you, you know, sometimes we tend to put our confidence in temporary things and things that may disappoint us. The word confidence here, it means a trust. It means faith. And I'm telling you, folks, it's not a time to throw away our confidence and our commitment to Jesus Christ. I'm here to tell you, if you're looking for Jesus to just get things fixed up in your life, that's the wrong reason to come to Jesus. That's why many of his disciples, it said they turned and followed him no more. When he told them, I didn't come to just fix your life. I didn't come just to perform miracles. He said, I came to be your very life. I came to save your soul. I didn't just come to make your way a little bit better. I didn't come to give you more money. I didn't come to give you greater pleasures in this life or fix or get back all the things that you've lost. In fact, when you make a commitment to Jesus Christ, there'll be times as a believer when you feel like you're all alone. There'll be times as a believer when you wonder if this faith thing is real. If I'm saved, why am I going through this? Why do I feel like I'm so far from the presence of God? You'll have times when you feel like your prayers are hitting an iron ceiling, when you prayed everything you know to pray, and things don't seem to be getting better. In fact, it seems like maybe it's getting worse. As a believer by faith, when you make a commitment to Jesus Christ, there'll be times when you look in this word and it seems to confound you and make you scratch your head. But let me say, you don't come to Jesus just trying some spiritual experiment for a while and say, well, I think I'll give this church a try for a little while. I think I'll see how I like that preacher for a little while. You don't come to Jesus just because you hope that he can give you some kind of light at the end of the tunnel. You come to Jesus because you're a sinner and he's a Savior. And only faith in God and repentance will give you any hope whatsoever of discovering what reality and truth really are. You come to God not for what he can do for you, but because his son died on a cross so that your sins might be washed away, so that you might be declared righteous, and that he might save your soul for eternity. And church, I'm telling you, we're coming to a place we're going to have to count the cost. I believe it's time for God's people to quit looking for a transactional relationship with God. We're not seeing the results we want to see, or we're not getting what we want from God. So many times people will walk away and throw away their confidence and throw away their commitment in Jesus Christ. Over the years, I've seen all kinds of people come to Jesus for all kinds of reasons. I've seen people who have just walked away from their faith for this reason or for that reason. But I am telling us today, when we make a true commitment to Jesus Christ, when by faith we completely surrender our life to Jesus Christ, we're going to prosper as our soul prospers. We may be miraculously delivered out of some trouble. There may be times when we experience miraculous healing. There may be times when the presence of the Lord comes in and floods our soul to the place where it puts dancing in our feet. It puts the Spirit of God in our mouth. There may be moments you say, hey, I have never felt better. I've experienced the miraculous blessings and power of God, and praise God for that. Or after thousands of prayers have been prayed for you to be healed, you may still be sick. You may still experience loss. After you've been faithful to God, you may suffer more than you ever have. You may not have the financial favor that you were hoping for. You may not even have loved ones or friends that sometimes they'll just come and break your heart. There may be times and seasons that you just don't understand what is happening in your life. I've seen people come to Jesus so that he would heal them. I've seen people come to Jesus so they could get their spouse back. I remember one revival. We had a young man. He and his wife, it was just always an unstable thing. They were in and out and up and down, and they would be on the mountaintop one time. They would be down on the bottom rung the next. And I remember we had a revival service, and this young man came to the altar, and I began to pray with him and talked with him. And he said, I want to come to Christ. I want to get saved. He said, Brother John, I'm done with all the shenanigans. I'm done with the drugs that has messed up my marriage. I'm done with not being the husband I need to be. I'm done with not being the dad that I need to be. I'm going to serve the Lord. I want my wife to come back, Brother John. I told him, I said, the real question is, will you surrender your life to Jesus and serve and obey him if she doesn't come back? He didn't like that. He looked at me a little bit in disbelief, but he went on in the emotion of it all and said, I want to serve the Lord. I want to serve the Lord. But when he found out that she wasn't coming back, You know what happened? He threw away his confidence and his commitment to Jesus Christ. Folks, coming to Jesus does not fix all the problems in this life. He saves your soul. He comes to dwell inside of you. He will send the Holy Spirit that you may be baptized and filled and endued with power. And then through prayer and repentance and faith and trust, he will guide you through every one of the dilemmas you face. He will walk with you through the valley. He will climb with you to the highest mountaintop. He may not remove all the pain and the sorrow from your life, but I'm going to tell you, he'll give you an endurance to go through it. He doesn't come to make you comfortable. He comes to give you comfort in Jesus Christ. Folks, I'm telling you, hallelujah. So all this surface invitation stuff that we hear in the modern day church, come to Christ if you want the good life. Come to Christ where there's health, wealth, and prosperity. I haven't lived on this earth as long as some of you. I don't really know what the world defines as the good life. But I do know when I came to Christ, I do know that night when he baptized me with the Holy Spirit, I begin to realize there's a difference between what the world calls the good life and the abundant life and the eternal life that only comes through Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I have come to give you life and give it to you more abundantly. He never said on this earth, even one day would be all fun and all pleasure all the time. But he did say, I'll be with you every step of the way. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I will live in you. I will guide you. Psalms 34:19 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous. But I like this part. The Lord delivereth them out of them all. Out of them all. Folks, this is a matter of saying, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. When he doesn't seem like he hears me, you know what? I've got to pray anyway. When the Bible seems confounding to me, I got to read it. I got to dig deeper. I got to say, Lord, reveal this to me. When my family becomes more messed up now than it was, I've got to trust God. I've got to cover them in prayer. When there's pain that overtakes my body every single day, I got to lift my hands and bless the Lord anyway. I got to put my hand in the plow. I got to know where I'm going. My mind is made up. It's not a time for me to throw away my confidence in Jesus Christ. And do not throw away your confidence in the compensation of Jesus Christ. Don't let the enemy get you to a place where he says it's not worth it. He's whispering that in the ears of this generation all the time. That's what was happening in Hebrews. These Jewish believers in Christ, see, they were all caught up in Judaism, but they had been saved. And now they had become believers in Jesus Christ in this new way. They were being persecuted. They had their goods and their way of life even taken from them. They had been treated as castaways and cast outs. And some of them were saying, hey, this isn't worth it. I've come to Christ, and now all of a sudden it seems like everything in the world's against me. Let's just go back to Judaism. Let's just go back to rituals and dead religion that soothes our conscience. That was just a little bit easier. But the writer of Hebrews is saying, if you do, you're going to negate the blood of Jesus Christ. And he said, what you need is this. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence in verse 35. Which hath great recompense of reward. Meaning you'll be compensated with great reward. In other parts of the book of Hebrews, the writer talks about this reward. How Moses would rather suffer the affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, because he was aware, it said, of the recompense, the payday, the compensation, the reward that was coming if he would just be faithful to God. Even Jesus, the writer said, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God, because our Savior, he looked at ahead in time to the joy that was set before him. He looked ahead to rising from the dead. He looked ahead to ascending to the Father, and he's now set down right there before at the right hand of the throne of God. He's interceding for you. He's interceding for me. He put up with the misery of the cross. He endured the shame. He endured 3 nights in a tomb because he knew when he walked out of the tomb on the third day, he would defeat death, hell, and the grave for eternity. Hallelujah. That sin and the sin problem would be paid for once and for all. That the Father would be glorified for the joy that was set before him. He would be able to save sinful mankind. He would be able to reconcile God's prized creation back to him. He said, because of that, I can put up with this for a little while. So the writer was saying, if Jesus could do it, so can you. Amen. He said, you might suffer a little while. You won't be nailed to a cross like an animal. But the things of this world may be taken from you. You may weep for a season. But he said that weeping is only going to last for the night. Because praise God, joy is coming in the morning. I'm telling you, church, don't give up now. Somebody in this room this week, I just believe, has had the thought, I'm going to throw in the towel. This is not worth it. I can't do it. Let me tell you, the enemy's lied to you. You may not see a lot of good going on right now in this old world, but folks, what it looks like is not the way it is in the kingdom of God. It looks like evil's taking over. It looks like our way of life is being taken from us. But folks, God is in control. Christ, who is our life, he's in control. You can't take my life from me because Jesus is my life today. You know what? You can't take anything from me because I don't own anything to start with. When I got to South Carolina, I thought they wanted to take everything I had, just get my vehicles in this state. I still got one in Alabama I hadn't got yet. They said, sir, there is a $250 charge for every vehicle you want to bring into the state. That's on top of the taxes and the fees. I said, what is that, the welcome to South Carolina fee? And the man looked at me and thought, you're not very funny. But I'm telling you, folks, we get so wrapped up sometimes in things and stuff. None of it's mine. I'm just a steward of it for a little while. But I have him, and he has me. So I'm saying today, don't throw away your confidence, your faith. It's going to have great reward. You have no idea what's waiting on you today, brothers and sisters. You don't have a mind to even imagine it, to even think about it. You've never seen anything that can ever give you a glimpse of what is waiting on us in eternity compared to heaven. Folks, everything down here is a trash dump. We worry about stuff so much. You can go in my garage today. I went in my garage yesterday, and I thought, I put all the time and effort and money into trying to get all this junk from Alabama to here. I thought, I'm going to back a pickup truck up to it one day and realize this ain't nothing but garbage. This stuff's just going to burn. It's going to pass away. I might as well go ahead and throw it in the trash. I'm not saying you've got to be some vagabond. I'm not saying you got to live in some box or something. I'm talking about, folks, we have gotten so ingrained in the things and the stuff of this life. It's all going to pass away, and we can't even imagine. We're trying to build our kingdom here, but we can't imagine on what is waiting for us if we will only be faithful. Hang on, hang on. Don't give up on God. Don't give up on His Word. There is a great reward waiting for you in heaven. Eye hath not seen, ear has not heard the things that God has prepared for them that love Him. Hasn't even entered into the heart of man. Verse 36 says, for ye have need of patience. My wife will tell you, that's when I get in the prayer closet, because I don't get it naturally. Ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. Folks, we need to quit worrying about tomorrow. Slow down. Be quiet. Live one day at a time. So that after you have done the will of God, what is the will of God? You say, Brother John, trust Him, obey Him, talk to Him, serve Him. And after you've done the will of God, He said, ye may receive the promise. I'm saying today, it's not a time to throw away our commitment to Jesus Christ. It's not a time to throw away our compensation in Jesus Christ. It's not a time to throw away our confidence of the coming of Jesus Christ. He said in verse 37, for yet a little while, and he that shall come will come. That's pretty plain, isn't it? He that shall come will come and will not tarry. The Hebrew writer said, for yet a little while. And he talks like that because, folks, this is all about eternity. When you compare time to eternity, it's just a little while. We don't really have a long time. We are headed towards eternity. And that's why the writer says, for yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Why does he include the words and will not tarry? Because he knew there would be an element of people, even in the church, that would say, well, my Lord is delaying His coming. In other words, that person that sat next to you last Sunday and shouted and spoke in tongues and got in a big way, and now they're not here and now they're gone and we don't know where they're at, they let a little span of time get to them. They said, man, we've just been preaching this stuff for years, but my Lord's delaying His coming. I got a chance to get a little deeper into the pleasures of this life and this world. We have been and are in a time right now, it seems to be draining the life out of us. People can't keep up with their schedules. They can't keep up with everything they've got scheduled on the calendar. We're not the people we were before all this pandemic started. The last 3 years has changed us, and we're going through something that has been wearing us down, and I believe the enemy, folks, has gotten angrier. I believe we're seeing the birth pains of the end times. The book of Isaiah foretells the end time where the pains and the sorrow take hold on this world. It will be a pain, the Bible says, as a woman that travaileth. I feel sorry for these young ladies. They're about to give birth. I think it's a joy, it's a great thing in their life, but they're going to have to do the work. And as they do, it says, as a woman travaileth, things are going to happen faster. They're going to happen more violently. The pain is going to intensify because, folks, Jesus Christ is coming back to this earth. Even the creation, the Bible tells us, is going to be crying out for Jesus to come and deliver it from the curse that is on it. Just this week, we've seen another natural disaster, another earthquake happen. And, folks, we who are waiting on Jesus to come in the clouds, who are rapture ready, know that, hey, we're not going to face the final birth pains in this tribulation. But as I have lived my life just this very week, I have sensed that things are happening quicker with more intensity. Folks, darker is getting darker. Light is getting lighter. Confusion is getting more confusing. Division is getting more divided. And truth, folks, should be clear to those who are lovers of the truth more than as ever has been before. We ought to be loving the truth more than we ever have before. So that we're living, those that are living unholy, it says we'll be unholy still. But those that are hungry and thirsty for righteousness will cry out for more of Jesus Christ. The intensity of our personal battles is increasing. And in the midst of those battles that we're facing, I'm saying it's time for God's people to cry out, come, Lord Jesus, come. It's time for us to have greater confidence that He's coming to catch His bride, the church away, true believers in Christ, pulled out of this world. It's time for us to have confidence that He said, if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again. I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, ye may be also. I'm saying don't throw that hope away in this hour. Don't throw away your confidence in the faith that you have in Jesus Christ. Don't throw away your confidence that there's a reward that's coming. Don't throw away your confidence that He's going to pull you out of this whole world and His wrath is going to be intensified. As they come to the music, I'm saying today, don't throw away your confidence in the complete victory of Jesus Christ. The writer simply tells us in verse 38, now the just shall live by faith. You see, that comes from a passage in Habakkuk where the prophet was complaining to God that people were just getting away with sin. Especially Judah, he was saying. How can you allow these sins of Judah? Lord, do you not punish sin? Lord, have you not seen what's going on? You know, it's easy for us to get in that mode. Man, I can get in that mode. Man, I can fuss about Joe Biden. I can fuss about politicians. I mean, I've lost every bit of confidence in Washington, D.C. I can fuss about that. I can say, Lord, why don't you get a hold of this corruption? Why don't you get a hold of this mess? Lord, why don't you do something about all this stuff that's happening? I can get on that bandwagon real easy. We think, why are people getting away with such injustice in this world? Let me say today, nobody's getting away with anything. You can go all the way back through history. Every injustice, every lying, every cheating, every stealing, everything that's ever been done wrong in the history of the world, it's being written down in books, and people will give account for it one day before the Lord. He said, vengeance is mine. It belongs to me. I'll repay. I'll recompense. So I'm saying, if you're anything like me, it's not a time for us to sit around and stew about all the things that are going on and wonder, why? Why, God, are you not doing something? He is doing something. And when you walked in the door this morning and felt the presence of God, He's doing something. He's not just, He's just not doing what we want Him to do right now sometimes. There's going to be a time where God finally says, hey, it's time for me to judge this world in righteousness. He's going to do it. And I'm saying right now in this time, when we look around and we get frustrated and we get upset, I've got to live on my knees. I've got to live in a spirit of repentance. I've got to walk before the Lord in righteousness with pure heart and clean hands because I want everything that He has done for me. I've got to be filled full and fresh of the Holy Ghost. I've got to be led by the Spirit of God. I can't let this old nature take over. I can't throw away the confidence that I have as a new creature in Jesus Christ. He goes on to say, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Now there it is. He said, anybody that says I quit, anybody that says, I don't know, I just don't want to do this anymore, he said, my soul has no pleasure in you. But verse 39, I like this. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. Folks, God didn't save you for you to turn back. That's why we sing that old song, I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. And then we always say it again, no turning back. Brother Staten, you remember all them trips to the pool at camp? All these kids get saved, and you're baptizing one right after another. You know what we're singing? I've had decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Though none go with me, still, he said, I will follow. Hallelujah. Folks, when we come to God's house, we ought to come in worshiping. It ought to be an atmosphere around here. Hey, if there's not an atmosphere that doesn't seem like worshiping, you ought to make it that way. If your neighbor looks like they sucked on a dill pickle right before they walked in this place, you know what you ought to do? You ought to raise your hands and worship your Savior until that bleeds over off onto them. And all of a sudden that sour face comes in contact with a Savior. A Savior that gave us freedom and life and joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but the Bible said righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You ought to thank God he died for you, that he's kept you, that he's providing for you. You ought to just for a moment think about where you could have been if it had not been for the goodness and the mercy of God. You know what, today we can stand up and say, though he slay me, I will trust him. I may lose my earthly life, but my times are in his hands, because what he does is always good. It's always right. It's always just. I'm his child. I bless his name. You know, there's something about the American economy today and how we've lived. It makes us think that we're going to take things with us. We put confidence in stuff. I've seen people shove chewing tobacco in a casket for their loved one. I've seen them put bologna and crackers down in a casket. Really? We've lived in a way that we think we're going to take stuff with us. We'll sit around, and I love a clean car, but we'll sit around and obsess over our trinkets and our toys and our things. Nothing wrong with that in its place. It's okay to have a hobby. But everything I have around me, folks, it's a gift from God. And he said, I came into this world naked, and that's the way I'm going to leave it. The only thing that won't burn up is the truth in my heart. And I'm saying, be encouraged, church. It's not going to be much longer. Don't cast away your confidence. Don't throw away your faith today. There's a reward coming. Jesus is coming. I believe for this church, revival's coming. I believe those prayers that you have prayed and prayed and prayed for your unsaved loved ones, I don't believe they've hit an iron ceiling. I believe they've been bottled up in heaven. I believe the Lord has heard every one of them. I believe he sees the heart of Somerville Family Worship Center. I believe he sees your praise. I believe he sees you when you walk in here and you don't feel like lifting your hands, but you do it anyway. Who needs encouragement today? Who needs assurance as we all stand? If you need that, I felt like somebody needed that, because your pastor needs that too. Who needs encouragement today? Why don't you come? Why don't you come and say, Lord, I'm trusting you completely today. Everything that I am, everything that I have, everything I'm going through, Lord, I am trusting you, and I am not going to throw away my confidence in Jesus Christ. I'm not going to throw away what he has done and what he's going to do for eternity in my life. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. My confidence today is in the complete victory of Jesus Christ. You see, folks, it wasn't just a partial victory. He defeated death, hell, and the grave, and everything that we're facing one day. He's going to be victorious over all of it. Who would come today? Who would say, I just need some encouragement? I just need to reassure myself that I haven't put my confidence in the wrong things. I just need encouragement in the Lord. You know, the Bible said David encouraged himself in the Lord. He reassured himself. He knew that his confidence was in the Lord. How many today would come? Give me some prayers. Give me some encouragers today. Give me some people around these today that say, hey, I'm not going to throw away my confidence, and I'm not going to let my brother or sister do it either. How many would say that today? Come and join me in prayer all around this altar, and let's say, Lord, I'm not going to throw away my confidence in Jesus Christ. I'm not going to throw it away. All over this building, I want us today just to begin to worship him. Grab the hand of the one next to you. Raise a hand to the Lord, whatever you feel like doing today. But we are not going to lose our confidence in who Jesus Christ is. We're not going to lose our confidence in our Savior. We're not going to lose our confidence that he is dealing with our hearts and our lives. We're not going to lose confidence that he can save. He can save our loved ones. He can change your situation. I'm not going to lose confidence today that he's a healer. I'm not going to lose confidence today that he can turn your life around. I'm not losing confidence that he wants to bring revival to this church. All over this room, let's pray together today. Lord, we come to you today, God. Lord, in this place today, God. Lord, don't let us lose confidence in who you are. God, the enemy has tried. He's tried in every way, Lord, to pull and tug and cause us to put our confidence in things, in stuff, in finances, in retirements, Lord, in possessions, in governments. But Lord, I pray all of this world is passing away, God. But the one thing that's not passing away is you, Lord. Your very word spoken today, God. It's truth. It's life, God. We can put our confidence in who you are. We can put our confidence in your word today, God. Lord, help us not to throw it away, but realize, God, Lord, you're doing something. You're working all things out. The pressures of this life, if we'll be faithful, God. You are faithful, God. And Lord, let us be faithful, God. In the name of Jesus, God, I pray, sweep over this room, God, and give us confidence in who you are, Lord, today, and who Jesus Christ is today, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, Lord.
Hallelujah. Across the grave. Chains, breathe my soul for the first time.
to heaven. Hallelujah. It didn't say when half of us get to heaven. It said when we all get there. You say, Brother John, what's your vision? That we all get to heaven. It's in a nutshell right there. That's what I want to see. If you're looking forward to that day, smile at somebody next to you. Listen, don't forget about all the things that are going on in this church over the next few weeks. I believe we have a ladies' luncheon. Is that next Saturday? 11:30. And you got to sign up.
Yes.
So if you want to eat, you need to put your name on the list. All right? It's nothing big. You just put your name on the list, it means there will be food for you. Ladies, it's at 11:30 next Saturday. We want you to be a part of that. I do need to meet with the executive board quickly, very quickly, in my office right after service. I know there's some festivities going out. We're celebrating another baby coming into the family of God, and we're excited about that. So I know it, today there's a shower there for the Ladson family, so let's just be praying for them, excited about that. Chris, look at me. Did something happen in your life this weekend? It did. What happened?
I have
kind of
married, yeah.
Oh, man. Well, that's exciting, and be praying for Chris and Kylie. Reagan, why don't you give us a wave up there? Something happened like that in your life this weekend, too? She's engaged to be married. Let's celebrate with her. Amen. Amen. I know they're excited, and we're praying for them, and a lot of wonderful things happening in the church. So with all of that said, just be happy. Smile at your neighbor. We've been in the presence of God, and as you leave this place today, know that, hey, we've got a great reward coming when we all get to heaven. If we don't make it by Wednesday, we'll have service here again, 7 o'clock Wednesday night. Amen. You're dismissed.